Good morning, students. In the last session, we have discussed about the modes of reproduction until regeneration, budding, and vegetative propagation. And vegetative propagation, it is very much advantageous to the plants in various respects, like the plants that are produced by vegetative propagation, they start giving fruits and seeds earlier than compared to the plants which are produced from the seeds. Genetically, the plants that are produced by vegetative propagation, they are more similar to their parent plants. So that due to the genetic similarity with parent plants, the vegetative propagated plants will retain most of the parental characteristics intact with them. Right? And the plants which have lost the capacity of producing seeds can be easily produced by vegetative propagation method. These are various things which we have learned about vegetative propagation. If you observe the plants from the aspect of this vegetative propagation, we are getting new plant from vegetative propagules, that is, from the part of a stem, from the part of a root, from the part of a leaf, like that. That means the part of the stem, the part of the root, the part of the leaf, they are having the cells which can give rise all other types of cells. Total types of cells by which the new plant can be constructed of. So plant cells have got the ability of producing total or all types of cells. In many plants, many of the growing cells, many of the growing cells are dividing cells in the plant. If they are given suitable conditions, any of the growing cells from the plant, it can give rise all other types of cells and can produce total plant. This ability is called totipotency. What it is? Totipotency. Totipotency is the ability of the growing plant cell to give rise all other types of cells using which the entire plant can be constructed of under suitable conditions. Not randomly, taking one growing cell and throwing it in the soil and asking it to grow complete plant, it will not grow. There are certain specific conditions that are required. If such conditions are provided in laboratory, we can produce plants from the cells that are separated from the growing parts of the plant body. So this process is called tissue culture. Growing of new plants by removing tissue or separating cells from growing tips of the plant body is called tissue culture. Okay. How this tissue culture is carried out? There are various proper sequence of steps. Number one, as already it is said in the definition, first step is removing the tissue or separating the cells from the growing tips of the plant body under aseptic conditions. Means you need to do it under sterilized conditions. I have already told this thing has to be carried out under specific conditions. So you are separating the tissue from growing tips of the plant body. Are you separating the cells from growing parts of the plant body under specific sterilizing conditions or aseptic conditions? Then transferring these separated tissue or cells to an artificial culture medium. Culture medium means you will prepare this medium using various types of nutrients. Nutrients means which provide various mineral elements for the cell division and growth of the cells, plant cells, which is separated from the growing tips of the plant body. So, placing these separated cells in an artificial medium that promotes the division of these cells. By that division of these cells, an undifferentiated mass of cells is going to be formed. You have added only few cells, and using the nutrients from the culture medium, these cells divide, and these cells are all same. They are not differentiated. Undifferentiated mass of cells is formed. Mass is formed. This undifferentiated mass of cells is called callus. What it is? Callus. Now, transfer this callus to another medium in which, along with the growth nutrients, you have added phytohormones or plant growth hormones. Auxins, gibberellins, cytokines, these are said to be growth promoting hormones. Ethylene and abscisic acid are said to be growth inhibiting hormones. You have added now growth promoting hormones in the medium, and you have just transferred the callus to this medium in which phytohormones are present. What is the essence of these phytohormones? They will make this callus to get differentiated into different parts like the roots, stem, leaves, etc. So that from this undifferentiated mass of cells or from this callus, when you have transferred this callus to an artificial medium in which phytohormones are present, the plantlets or small plants are formed by the differentiation of the cells in this callus. Okay. Now, these plantlets can be carefully taken out from the laboratory and can be planted in the soil, and new plants can be formed or developed from these plantlets. This is what tissue culture. Tissue culture is generally employed for ornamental plants of whose normal propagation is very difficult by either seed method or by normal vegetative propagation method. So that in laboratory, under all aseptic conditions, you are allowing the growth of those new plantlets, which is not possible under normal general conditions outside the laboratory in the nature. So, this is the extension for your vegetative propagation method. Now, last one, that is spore formation. Spore formation is carried out in certain fungi like a bread mold or black mold, which is also, whose original name is Rhizopus. Rhizopus is a fungus, which is observed on breads and which appears in black color. So only it is also called bread mold or black mold, because mold word is commonly used for many types of fungi. And this fungus will have fine thread-like structures in its body. These fine thread-like structures are intertwined with each other and form a network-like structure. This network form of fungus is called mycelium, and each fine thread is called hypha, and many threads are called hyphae. These fine threads are hyphae. They bear tiny, means very very small blob, like small blob, ball like structures are present, which are also called tiny blob on stick structures. Tiny blob on a stick structures. What is tiny blob on a stick structure? It is the sporangium. Singular is sporangium. Many sporangia. So on each hypha, one sporangium is present. On many hypha, many sporangia are present. What do these sporangia contain? These sporangia contain special cells which are called spores. These spores, when they are just finding sufficient moisture having conditions, they will grow into new fungi, new fungus. And each spore, it is covered with a hard outer covering or cell wall. Each spore is covered with hard outer covering or salva. These fungal salvas are made up of a specific mucopolysaccharide. What it is? Mucopolysaccharide. That is chitin. Right? So this chitin is the mucopolysaccharide. In living organisms, in class 9, we have learnt that the bacteria, fungi and plants, they cells have what? Salvas. These salvas are made up of polysaccharide material. In the case of plants, it is cellulose, which is a simple polysaccharide. In the case of bacteria, it is neuroaminoglycolic acid, neuroaminoviramic acid, is a complex polysaccharide. And chitin also is a complex polysaccharide, that is mucopolysaccharide. This mucopolysaccharide is the toughest substance, so that these fungal spores, they do not get spoiled or damaged. Hence they are highly protected because of this mucopolysaccharide made or chitin made cell walls. They are protected from various types of environmental pressures like desiccation or heat or whatever the environmental pressures are there. Right? And when these spores are coming in contact with sufficient moisture containing surfaces along with some food, then they germinate into new fungi, right? Or new rhizopus. This is 8.2 of the chapter How Do Organisms Reproduce. Under this one, some questions are given in blue color. I discuss those questions. You try to answer them in your notebook. How does binary fission differ from multiple fission? Binary fission and multiple fission both take place in unicellular organisms only. But binary fission, it forms only two daughter cells. Multiple fission, it forms many daughter cells. How will an organism be benefited if it reproduces through spores? Just now we have discussed. These spores, they can be present in the environment without getting damaged for longer periods because of their hard outer covering, which is made up of chitin. So the organism will be benefited. Okay, the species that is forming the spores, it is more benefited because of the chitin made cell walls, so that these spores are protected for longer periods without getting damaged or without getting died. Right? Can you think of reasons why more complex organisms cannot give rise to new individual organisms through regeneration? Regeneration, it is a very simple mode of sexual reproduction, wherein the low complexity having organisms can form complete new organisms from their body parts. The body parts are getting cut. If the complexity of the organism increases, these body parts do not contain the specific cells with which all other types of cells can be formed. It is practically possible only in lower level of organisms, not in higher complexity having organisms. Why? In lower complexity having organisms, the cell types that make up the body of the organism are limited, which can be formed from the specific cell types which are present in most of the parts of the cell, body of the organism. Whereas in higher complexity having organisms, the specific cell types that are meant for reproduction, which can give rise all other cell types by which the complete body of the organism is formed, they are not present in all parts of the body. They are present only in some specific part of the body. And by normal sexual reproduction only, these cells are made utilizing to produce new organism, but not by regeneration method. Why is vegetative propagation practiced for growing some types of plants? I already have discussed. In order to get the fruits and seeds earlier, and in order to get the same beneficial characteristics from parent plant to the new daughter plants, the plants in which the capacity of producing seeds is lost, in order to propagate those plants, also vegetative propagation is used. Right. Why is DNA copying mechanism an essential part of the process of reproduction? Reproduction is producing new organ. Every organism is having some body design. If body design has to be made, information for the body design is needed. Information for the body design is present in DNA. If DNA copy is not transferred to the new organism, then body design cannot be made. So only in order to transfer the DNA or information, a copy of the DNA has to be prepared. DNA copying mechanism allows to prepare that copy, right? So only DNA copying mechanism is an essential part of the reproduction, right? Hope you all have understood all these answers. Try to answer, okay, using the information that is provided already in the previous 4 sessions of this chapter, right? Thank you.